you know, you plan things in a certain way, and you suddenly find yourself doing something that's 180 degrees different. And then sometimes it works really well, and you feel like, wow, that really came together. And other times you think, oh my God, I can't believe this is where we are. And sometimes when it's not working out, it's because it's what you planned. And other times when it's not working out, it's because it didn't. It's like you never really know. But having a plan, you know, I have learned in some cases the hard way, is the most, you know, critical thing, because otherwise you don't know what you're setting up. You don't know what you're, you know, what to emphasize, because if you don't know the inevitable of the story, you know, you're just as good as your last, you know, sequence or effect or joke or whatever, but you want to be leading to something inevitable.
Do I really look like a guy with a plan? You know, I just do things.
What's going on, everyone? Jeremy here from The Coordinator. Hope you're having a wonderful day. Yet another embarrassment for Star Wars. Earlier this week, the fans took over the franchise in a virtual way, fixing the franchise via Twitter. And today, just moments ago, a new article came out from Collider where J.J. Abrams essentially said, yeah, we didn't have a plan. It probably would have helped. It probably would have helped. That's his statement. Like one smart commenter below the post saying, in related news, the captain of the Titanic acknowledged it probably would have been better if they had avoided the iceberg. J.J. Abrams acknowledges it probably would have been better if they had approached Star Wars sequel trilogy with a plan. They admit they had no plan whatsoever, just like we all knew. Before I get into this hilarious story, you know those globes behind me? I've obtained a special discount code just for you. Check this out. One of the most common questions I get on this channel is, quite frankly, what are those sweet globes behind you and where can I get one? Well, I've been collecting MOVA globes for several years now, and I'm really happy to bring them on to the channel as a sponsor and deliver you, the viewer, a special discount code. MOVA globes are, of course, rotating globes powered by light, first of its kind technology, and it'll turn when exposed to ambient light. As you see, I'm down here in the basement in the studio and they run fully powered. There are hidden magnets that provide the movement, no batteries or messy cords required. It's also a great gift for the person that might have everything. It's an absolute conversation starter and it looks great on your bookshelf or over a fireplace or really anywhere in your house. There are over 40 designs, including world maps, outer space, and famous artworks. The Outer Space Collection, which I happen to like the best, features graphics provided by NASA and JPL and includes planets, moons, asteroids, and constellation designs. For you, my viewers, I've got a special 10% off promo code THEQUARTERING. When you go to movaglobes.com, use promo code THEQUARTERING and send me a picture with your new globe. I absolutely love these things and I'm so happy to provide a discount for you all. Hey, people always ask me about them. Now you can save some money. And maybe I'll find a discount code for creepy crawler machines too next or something. You guys let me know what you like and I'll work to try and get those sponsorships arranged. J.J. Abrams acknowledges it would have been better if they had approached a Star Wars sequel trilogy with a plan. In other words, this was the extent of their plan with one of the most important franchises in history. Random BS, go! It was actually worse than that. They hired someone who hated the first film to do the second one, then rehired the first guy who hated the second film to do the third one. Active corporate espionage couldn't have torpedoed this better. I mean, first of all, J.J. Abrams, I know that his name is attached to like literally every project, and I this is nothing personal. I don't know him, but I don't get excited when I see new film headed up by J.J. Abrams. I just think, oh, it's some other, you know, random, forgettable Hollywood dreck. Maybe his name used to mean something, but it doesn't to me anyway. You see, in no way does Rise of the Skywalker hold together with anything. The entire Star Wars fandom is absolutely demolishing them. Also, J.J. Aim acknowledges it probably would have been better if they had approached Alias' final season with a plan. You could probably say this is Game of Thrones. This could possibly be a meme. Kathleen Kennedy brazenly lied about having no source material to work with after Disney unceremoniously threw out hundreds of novels, comics, games, and TV shows. Why, they said, we don't have 800-page novels. So they knew it was another trilogy, and they still did not have a plan. Good job. This is an absolute hilarious. Like, this is bad enough to get Kathleen Kennedy fired. Was it not glaringly obvious after the second film? The third film, they just dropped main characters without doing anything. This is what we all knew. Here's just a simple. I mean, this is exactly what we would have expected. And this just days after Star Wars fans take over Lucasfilm and quote, fix the franchise using a viral tweet. If you were given the key to Star Wars, what would you do with the franchise? Twitter users answer this very important question. Of course, same. Casper Larson as Mara Jade, directed by Rian Johnson. That would be great. You wake up the head of Lucasfilm. What's the first thing you do? I don't know. Fire everybody. This person writes Vader trilogy set between episode 3 and Rogue One. That would be cool. Solo 2. No. Live action Star Wars series between A New Hope and Empire. Okay. Rogue 2. Yeah, I think Rogue One was the only respectable Star Wars film that came out of Disney Lucasfilm. That's my opinion. You could make arguments for some of the films being acceptable. But Rogue One was the only one that felt like, especially after it was, you know, followed up with so much terrible, forgettable stuff. Make a spin-off series about Finn, of course. There was the origin story of Watto. I mean, an offshoot in an episode of something that might actually be fun. I don't know. I make Jar Jar Binks Sith Lord canon. There's a lot, and you know, ultimately, here's the article. J.J. Abrams reflects on Star Wars and when it's critical to have a plan. McFly, it's probably always critical to have a plan. I don't know what else to say. J.J. Abrams was never supposed to direct more than one Star Wars film. When he was first approached about tackling Episode 7, he turned it down. It took some convincing on then new Lucasfilm head Kathleen Kennedy to get Abrams to agree to sign on. In doing so, Abrams said at the time he was excited about the idea of creating a foundation from the ground up, which other stories might grow. Indeed, The Force Awakens had an unenviable task of introducing brand new characters that fans would want to follow while also servicing fans' desires to see old favorites back on the screen. Abrams co-wrote the script with Lawrence Kasdan after Michael Arndt wrote initial drafts, pulled it off, not only providing a satisfying conclusion to Han Solo's arc, but making the world fall in love with Rey, Finn, Poe, and BB-8. I don't think that The Force Awakens was great. I know it made a lot of money and it was a big deal. It was really just a retelling of an old Star Wars story. I don't think that the world fell in love with Rey at all. I think that Daisy Ridley did a fine job with the material she was given. I don't think the world cared about Poe. He was basically a side character that didn't get much extra love. As Abrams was working on The Force Awakens, Lucasfilm wanted to get the next two films in the sequel off the ground and thus hired Rian Johnson to write each and direct episode 8, and Colin Trevorrow to co-write episode 9. The idea that each director would build on the previous filmmaker had crafted, leading to sort of creative handoff. So when Abrams signed on to take over one director to the next, in Johnson's case, it meant following certain threads that Abrams built, like Rey's confrontation with Luke and dropping others like Snoke. The Last Jedi was a critical success, but it was divisive among some diehard fans, almost all diehard fans. These decisions left to veer left when it looked like Abrams was plotting the course to the right. So when Abrams signed off to take over episode 9 after Trevorrow left the project, he had yet another unenviable task, albeit a completely different one. He had to finish a story he started, but one that had taken alternate routes in the middle chapter, routes that Abrams wouldn't necessarily have gone down. He goes on to say, personally, I enjoy the creative offhand between Abrams and Johnson. I like The Force Awakens and The Last Jedi. like feel like distinct films, each following themes and threads, sure, maybe that's fine. So when I spoke to Abrams for a recent press day about the 10th anniversary of Super 8, which is a good film, by the way, I asked him about his creative handoff. Specifically, does he feel the Star Wars trilogy would have benefited from having a plan from the very beginning? In answering, Abrams drew from his wealth of experience in television. I've been involved in a number of projects that have been, in most cases, series that have ideas that begin the thing where you feel like you know where it's going to go. And sometimes it's an actor who comes in. Other times it's in a relationship that, as written, doesn't quite work. And the things that you think are just going to be so well received crash and burn. And other things that you think, oh, that'll be a small moment, that's an episode, a one episode character, suddenly become hugely important and part of the story. I feel like that's a lesson I've learned a few times. And there's something, especially with the lockdown year, working with writers has become clear. The lesson is that if you have to plan things, you have to plan things the best you can. You always need to be able to respond to the unexpected. And the unexpected can come in all sorts of forms. And I do think there's nothing more important than knowing where you're going. Imagine putting together a sequel trilogy, okay? And not having any idea how you want it to go. Abrams acknowledged that the plan is the thing that gets in the way sometimes. There are projects that I've worked on where we have some ideas but hadn't worked them through yet. Sometimes we have ideas but we weren't allowed to do them the way we wanted to. I've had all sorts of situations where you plan things in a certain way and suddenly find yourself doing a 180. That sometimes it works really well and you feel like, wow, that really came together. Well, yeah. So what he's really saying is sometimes I have good movies, sometimes I have bad. Ultimately, the filmmaker said that he learned the hard way that it's better to have a plan and be willing and able to change it than to not have one at all. You just never really know. But having a plan, I have learned in some cases the hard way in the most critical thing, because otherwise you don't know what you're setting up. You don't know what to emphasize, because if you don't know the inevitable of the story, you're just as good as your last sequence, effect, joke, or whatever you want to be leading to something inevitable. Why is this something that's a hot take? Why? Of course you want to have an idea how this sequel goes. I don't understand this. I mean, this goes on to say he's not wrong. Examples of working TV are especially relevant. Breaking Bad had overreaching plan of taking character from Mr. Chips to Scarface over the course of the series, but creator Vince Gilligan also planned on ending off Aaron Paul's Jesse Pinkman at the end of season one. It was only after he saw Paul's chemistry with Bryan Cranston that he changed his mind, and Jesse became an integral part of one of the best TV shows ever made. Still haven't seen it. And I don't know if I ever will. People say it's good, but now I feel like it's been overhyped where I'm just going to have such high expectations. Lost, with showrunner Damon Lindelof, revealed that ABC kind of forced his hand in making them extend the story behind what they felt would be right for the series. So Abrams' thoughts here check out. Well, I mean, maybe, you know, having a plan is probably a good idea. Admitting you didn't have a plan for the most important film franchise in modern day history is hilarious. Or admitting that out loud, that you didn't have a plan. Lol, no S. So do you think, J.J. Abrams? It took him 6 years to admit this. Truly stunning and brave. No, you don't say. Who have ever thought that? I mean, what? No kidding. It also helps when you want to tell a story and not pander to a certain crowd that hated the last set of movies. What? Of course! Fire Kathleen Kennedy. Well, I mean, I don't know. I think they need to have an entire clearing of a house at Lucasfilm, except for Filoni and Favreau, and maybe anybody they handpicked to stick around, because I don't trust any of them. I like that they admit it was a failure, though. It's good to finally hear. I hope you enjoyed this video. We'll talk to you again. Don't forget to check out MOVA. Pick yours up today with my special promo code. We'll talk to you again real soon.